हाँ, वेलकम बैक टू वीडियो क्लास टू। इन माई लास्ट प्रीवियस वीडियो क्लास जस्ट आई गेन इंट्रोडक्शन पार्ट ऑफ ट्रस्ट। इन दैट यू आर डिस्कस द बेसिक डेफिनेशन एंड ऑल्सो यू डिस्कस डिफरेंट टाइप्स ऑफ ट्रसेस। दोज ट्रसेस आर द प्लेनर ट्रसेस एंड द स्पेस ट्रसेस। वाट आर प्लेनर ट्रसेस एंड वाट आर स्पेस ट्रसेस, दैट इज ऑलरेडी आई डिस्कस्ड इन वीडियो क्लास वन। लेट इज अगेन आई एम गोइंग टू रिकॉल दोज टू टर्म्स। द प्लेनर ट्रसेस आर नथिंग बट the whatever the slender bars used for construction of trusses, all the members whatever chosen, those will going to be lie on a single plane. Such type of trusses are called as planar stresses. And for the analysis of those stresses, they will be considered as a two-dimensional body. Understood? Nothing but each and every node having 2 degrees of freedom for particular truss member. Another type of truss is called space truss. The space truss are nothing but all the members used for construction of the trusses will not going to be lie on a single plane. Nothing but they will be situated on different plane. Such type of trusses are called space trusses. For analysis purpose, this type of trusses will going to be considered as three-dimensional body. In this video class 2, we are going to solve some problems which are pertaining to trusses. Just look into this problem now. Just you will solve the simple problem regarding the trusses. Just look into the slide. That is problem number 1. Let me rewrite the problem statement now. For the 2-bar truss, as shown in figure, determine nodal displacement and stress in each member. And also take E is equal to 200 gigapascal. They are given in the problem. Now we need to do this problem now. Okay, for this we need to calculate displacement for the structure and also the stresses induced in the member due to the application of load, that is given, that is 50 kilonewton, that is acting at node 2. Okay, and also they have given area of the first element and also area of the second element they have given, that is 1200 mm square and 1000 mm square they have given. Now let us solve this problem step by step. See, whenever in especially in when you are going for analysis of stresses in FEA, the first thing you have to do is convert that physical problem into finite element model. That's the first step we need to follow for that. In examination also, you people has to do first creation of FEA model. For that he'll have a marks for that. Okay, see here, now I'm going to create the FEA model. And also see, just as for the given structure, physical structure, I am going to draw that one. And also they are given 2 elements here. Just observe the figure, the given question. And how many nodes are there here? 3 nodes, 1, 2, 3 already they are mentioned, along with 2 elements are given. Okay. And as for that, I am going to drawing FE model for that. Okay. Just you observe the FE model here. Same as well, I am going to mentioning 1, 2, 3 with respect to dimensions also. And also I mentioned 1 element and second element also, and also I mentioned their particular areas, that is 1200 mm square and 1000 mm square. Okay, now just you observe here, I have exactly at node 1, node 2, node 3 I have written Q1, Q2, Q3, Q4 and Q5, Q6. What are those are called? The Q1, Q2, Q3, Q4, Q5, Q6 are called as nodal displacement values. Nodal displacement values. See here, just like already people are familiar with analysis of bars, there each and every node having 1 degree of freedom. That's why the bar will be called as a one-dimensional body. But the stresses will be called as a, here you're going to use a planar stresses, or simply you can call it as a trusses. Here each and every node having 2 degrees of freedom. That's why for analysis the planar stresses will be considered as a two-dimensional body, just now I told in the previous slide. Here, that's why I'm mentioning Q1 and Q2. Nothing but what exactly Q1 Q2 meant for? These two are the nodal displacement values with respect to x-axis, with respect to y-axis. If I talked about 2ED element, nothing but it is away both the direction like x and y. 3 means x, y, z. See, this is how I represented similarly for second node. There you are going to represent Q3, Q4, nothing but those are the nodal displacement values of node 2 with respect to x, y similarly for with respect to x and y for Q5 and Q6. See, this is what you have to go for creation of FE model for the any physical problems of trusses. Okay, now what is the next step? Now after completion of creation of nest model, go for formation of or creation of nodal coordinate data. This is very much important table. Okay, as for this table, further table will be completed. Without this table, I cannot going to complete your third element connectivity data. What is it exactly, nodal coordinate data? How it can be filled? See, just read the headlines of that node numbers there, and also x and y coordinate. So by filling, just first you fill the first column. How many nodes are there here? Obviously from the figure, just you observe the figure here. How many nodes are there? 3 nodes are there. Just you represent those 3 nodes, 1 2 3. Okay, what exactly I have written 00 750? See, just listen how to write those values. Now see, while writing this value, just you recall what you have done in modeling and analysis lab during analysis of the bars. See, during analysis of bar, during creation of the model, there one of the node or at particular some point you are going to assume as a origin. Yes or no? There you are going to some node or some particular reference point you are going to assume. With the reference point, we are going to write down the how much the second node or third node or fourth node will be at a distance of origin. That we need to write here. Nothing but you take one as something, one node or some other node as a reference. With that reference point, just how far the other nodes will be situated, that we need to fill it in nodal coordinate data. Okay, see here, just observe the figure here. Just observe the figure here. Here in my problem, I will assume one as a reference point, one as a origin. That's why here in my table, I have written node 1 as a 0, 0. Okay, now with reference to figure again, node 2, with respect to origin, how far it is distance, how far it is at a distance from the reference node. See here, exactly you take at node 1, it is situated nearly 750 mm apart from x axis with a height of 500 mm. Just you observe the figure here. See, node will be situated from one node, nothing with reference to reference, it will be situated 750 mm along x axis at height of 500 mm from y axis. So that's what I have written here. With x axis at a distance of 750 mm, which will be situated at height of 500 mm. Now what about third node? Now third node, x axis obviously it will be 0 with reference you have taken, but it is situated at a height of 500 mm. See, this is how you have to create this nodal coordinate data. It doesn't mean that you have to take 1 as a reference or 2 as a reference or 3 as a reference. As you wish, you can choose anyone as a reference point, but with particular that reference point, we need to list out the what distance from the origin the other nodes will going to be situated, whether you have a negative values or positive values. That's why be careful. Always going to preference is given for if you take from left to right as a reference, so that it will become positive values. If you suppose if you take 2 as a reference, the other node values come in negative values. That's the reason always better for choosing from left to right as a left one is as a reference point, so that the right side will be going to get the positive values. Now so this is how we're going to create your nodal coordinate data. I have taken 1 as a reference, for that x will be 0, y will be 0, and 2 node will be situated at a distance of 750 mm from x axis at a height of 500 mm, and third node will be obviously it will be 0 with reference to x axis with a height of 500 mm. Now go for next filling of next step, that is called element connectivity data. Element connectivity data. What is that element connectivity data? The element connectivity data here, just look at the 4 or 5 columns here. In the first column, that is element, obviously from the figure they are given 2 elements will be there. That's what I have written, 1 and 2, and second column indicating initial node, third column is going to tells about final node, And third, fourth column will be length of the element, and fifth column will tell us about direction of cosine. Okay, let me start here. Element. As from the figure, you have two elements will be there. That's what I have written, element 1 and element 2. Here. Now, initial load and final load. Just look at the figure here. Okay. First element. Okay. Obviously, the first element is made up of two nodes. Those two nodes are node 1 and node 2. In that, we need to select which will going to take as initial node and which will you going to take it as a final node. It doesn't mean that I will take 1 as a initial node, 2 as a final node. As always, you can take 2 as a initial node and 1 as a final node also, but values will get negative. At last, the final answer will be again you are getting is same. Understood or not? For reference, the beginning node will be I am going to consider as a initial node and 2 as a final node. Okay. Come for next, second element. Just to observe the figure here. Second element. Obviously, second element is made up of again two nodes. Those two nodes are called node 2 and node 3. Here again, I am going to take as a 2 as a initial node and 3 as a final node. Okay. Now you have filled 3 columns. Go for next fourth column now. That is length of the element. Nothing but effect. L suffix E means nothing. E nothing but effective length of the element. Just for that, just directly go for the figure. Your problem. Effective length of the element. The element length you need to be filled there. First, directly for second element, they have given directly. That is 750 mm. That's what I have written here. 750 mm. For the first element, they have not mentioned here. So here, just to observe, there is no directly they have given your length of the element for the first element. But I can calculate through some other concept using called Pythagoras theorem. Using Pythagoras theorem, I can easily calculate the value of length of the element, that is under root of 750 square plus 500 square. If you do it, we are going to get as 901.387. Just you observe here. Just I have done here. That is length of the element. Effective length of the element 2 is there directly they have given there. Understood? Now that's what I have filled here. Next, go for direction of cosines. What are direction of cosines? See, direction of cosines are nothing presented by L and M. These direction of cosines are nothing but it is the angle made by the unit vector of particular structure with respect to XYZ coordinate system. Nothing but how much angle that is made by the direction of unit vector with respect to XYZ. That is going to represented by L and M. Always remember, L is pertaining to X axis, M is pertaining to Y axis. How to calculate these two now? Okay, for calculation of L and M, always you have to look after second step, that is nodal coordinate data table. That's why be careful for creation of nodal coordinate data. That will be depending upon further process. If you done wrong, their entire thing will be wrong. That's why always nodal coordinate data will be correct for further carrying out the answer. How to calculate now L and M? How I got 0.8, 0.55, minus 1, 0. Just you look into the next slide here, there will be a formula for that. What is the formula here? Here the formula will be, see, L will be there. Effective length of the second element directly given, first element so you have collected through Pythagoras theorem. Okay. How to calculate L and M? I told L be meant for always x axis, M will be for y axis. What is the formula for L? L nothing but x final node. X final node minus x initial node divided by effective length of the element, particular element. Just I am taking, see here, each element having their per corresponding L and M. L and M will be pertaining to first element also situated. Also L and M also calculated for second element also. Now I am going to calculate for first element. X final load. Just you look into the table now, nodal coordinate table now. During calculation of L and M, just you go through the second step, that is nodal coordinate data table. Now first I am talking about first element. During first element, this first element is obviously made up of two nodes, 1 and 2. Now don't look at third node at all. If I talk about L, just you observe X column only. If I talk M, just you observe Y column only. I am talking about first node, that L, that pertaining you have to see only x axis, which is among, I have taken x final node, just you observe the formula, x final minus x initial node, particular magnitude value you have to take, you need to take near node 2 along corresponding x value is how much now, that is I will taken as a 750 here, just final load, which only I have taken here, final load is 2. For 2 final load, what is the magnitude along x? 750. See, that's what I have written, 750 minus initial load. Which one you have taken initial load? 1. What is the corresponding magnitude that comes under x column is 0. Okay, no? And what is effective length here? 901.387. See, that's what I have calculated here. 750 x final load, that's magnitude along x column will be 750 minus x initial node along magnitude will be 0 along x column divided by effective. If you do it, you will going to get 0.832. Okay. Now, similarly, for m for, again for first element only. Don't see third element, third node here. Just to concentrate again. But instead of going for seeing x column, just you go for y column now. Okay. Again, same. Y final load. The formula will be again same, y final minus y initial node divided by effective length. Effective length is already same, that is 901.387. okay, now y, what is initial node, what is final node you have taken there, same 2, what is the value of 2 with respect to y column, final node y, magnitude is 500 minus 0 divided by effective length. If you do it, you are going to get 0.554. that is for the first element. Now, similarly, you need to calculate for second element also there. Okay. First, formula will be same, but just one thing you have to remember, that the for second element, the nodes will be changes. The first element is made up of first and second node, but whereas second element will be made up of node 2 and node 3. Just again for calculation of this, same formula will be there. Just now you just observe the element 2, which one you have taken as final node. Okay, no? 3, and which one is taken initial node? 2. Now go for seeing the nodal coordinate data table now. Now don't look at the node 1, because node 1 is not concerned with element number 2 now. Those are made up of only node 2 and node 3. I have taken node 3 as a final node, node 2 as an initial node. Now what is the magnitude value for node 3 in x column? That is 0. For 2 it is 750. 0 minus 750 and effective length already, that is, you know, value of directly they are given in the problem. 750, do it, you will get minus 1. Now go for m. Again m, just you look at the y column, only for the node 2 and 3, that will be 500 minus 500 divided by effective length 750. 500 minus 500, 0 by anything will be 0. See, this is how we need to fill the third step, that is called element connectivity data. Okay, dear students, once again I am telling you, element obviously depending upon the problem, you have to write element 1 and element 2. The initial and final node, that is left to you. Okay, whichever you want to take it as a initial and whichever you take it as a final, that is left to you. But you start with starting point, the 1, 2, 3, but it will be helpful for you. No, there is no confusion in that. Okay. If you take 2 and 3, 2 as a initial, 1 as a final also, no issue, but you will get negative values, nothing is going to happen in the calculation. Again, you are going to get, at last you will get same value. Okay, so this completes your third step, directly going to go for next step is called, already you are familiar, because already you have done this stiffness matrix in case of analysis of bars. The next step is here, elemental stiffness matrix. You have to create elemental stiffness matrix for number of elements that are going to present in the problems. In my problem, we have two elements. That's why I need to calculate two elemental stiffness matrix. Two elemental stiffness matrix, I need to do it now. Just element stiffness matrix. One thing you have to remember, this, the elemental stiffness matrix will be different for different structures. You might have already familiar with element stiffness matrix for the bars is, that is AE by L, that is area into Young's modulus divided by effective length of the element divided by L, nothing but effective length AE by L in the matrix of 1 minus 1 minus 1 1, that is for the bars. But it is for stresses, the stiffness matrix will be different, nothing but each and every structure having its own different stiffness matrix. Here for the element of stiffness matrix, formula for trusses will be, I have written here, that is AE by L. The suffix I have written E, nothing but that is the elemental, particular elements I have written, into the matrix of L square LM minus L square minus LM LM M square minus LM minus M square minus L square minus LM L square LM minus LM minus M square LM M square. Okay, don't feel that it is difficult to remember, it is easy to remember. Okay, the only you are going to play with only four words, that is L square LM LM M square. See, just the whatever the matrix you are going to write, just that matrix will be divided into four quadrants, better. Okay, here first, second, third and fourth quadrant. Okay, now already you are familiar quadrants. Okay, in that first and third quadrant you need to write with values of L square LM and M square with positive values, whereas your second and fourth quadrant will be written same values with negative values. Okay, now you got the idea or not? See, this is how you have to remember easy for writing examination or for any other internal problem, internal assessment tests. Okay, now you go for calculation of stiffness matrix for the first element as well as for the second element, because you have two elements, we need to calculate for two stiffness matrices. Okay, now K1 is equal to, here is how much they are given area here. Area directly they are given how much for first element, that is 1200 mm square, and second will be 1000 mm square. And Young's modulus they are given common, that is 2 into 10 to the power of 5 Newton per mm square. And effective length of the first element is 901.387. See, before, see, but easy for you. Just, I am talking about first element. For corresponding first element, what are the values of L and M? L will be again here, just you remember, or we have created in the last table itself. See here. For first element, L is equal to 0.832 and for M equal to 0.554. For that square, you keep it ready so that values can going to be put in your stiffness matrix. Okay, so just you keep it ready with that. That is L square is equal to 0.692 you got, M square is equal to 0.306 you got, LM is equal to 0.46 you got. Just to keep it ready, directly we can put in the matrix and we will solve for the stiffness matrix now. Okay, see here, just L square, now just now L square I calculated, I have put it in the formula L square, and I'll go LM also I calculated, M square, each everything you need to be put it in the matrix and also go for simplification now. After simplification, I have taken 10 to the power of 5 as a common, and remaining everything I have multiplied inside the matrices. Okay, inside the matrix I have calculated now. Okay, now see here, this is calculated value I have written there, 10 to the power of 5, that is kept as a common, kept outside the matrix, and these are the values you got after the multiplication with remaining term, that is excluding 10 to the power of 5. See here, after creation of stiffness matrix, I have written 1 2 3 4 1 2 3 4, because this is what will going to be helpful when you are going for adding your two stiffness matrix, nothing but while getting your global stiffness matrix. Why I have written 1, 2, 3, 4? Because your first element is obviously made up of two nodes. Okay, here each node having 2 degrees of freedom. That's why 2 nodes, how many degrees of freedom now? 2 into 4 degrees of freedom. That's why I have written 1, 2, 3, 4. Or else you can write Q1, Q2, Q3, Q4. Similarly for here, right answer Q1, Q2, Q3, Q4. Okay, only for addition purpose and nothing but people need not to confuse while during addition. I have written only for that purpose only I have written here. Okay, 1 2 3 4 and 1 2 3 4. Okay, similarly you go for calculation of stiffness matrix for the second element. Again same formula will be there, again keep it ready with L and M terms. L square is equal to 1 and M square equal to 0, LM equal to 0. Again the area of second element has given 1000 and Young's modulus is common. Again the length of the element is 750. Again I kept 10 to the power of common. See, one thing you remember, that it is no hard and fast rule that you have to maintain 10 to the power 5 as you wish, but both things you need to maintain common so that addition will become very easy for us. Okay, 10 to the power of 5 I kept outside and the remaining thing I have multiplied inside the matrices, and this is the value I got now. Okay, for this I have created 3 4 5 6 3 4 5 6, I have written at the top. Why? See, because your second element is made up of second node and third node. Okay, if the degrees of freedom represented is starts with 3, 4, not with 1, 2. Okay. That's why I have written 3, 4 and also for 5, 6. Okay. See, this is how you need to calculate your individual stiffness matrix for particular elements. What is the next step? Again, you go for global stiffness matrix. Addition of global stiffness matrix. Okay. Always one thing you remember, by seeing the problem, you can easily identify, visually you can say that what will be the global size of the stiffness matrix. Because how many nodes are there? 3. Into how many degrees of each node? 2. 3 into 2, if you multiply, you get 6. Obviously, your global size of the matrix, stiffness matrix, will be 6 cross 6. That's what I have written. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Now, you have to go for addition of 2 individual stiffness matrices to get the global stiffness matrix. Now, first look into the 1 cross 1. You need to add now 1 cross 1. How much value you got 1 cross 1 if you do it now? That is, just look into the first one, 1 cross 1, that is 1.84. That is 1.84. Next, again you go for 2 cross 1. What is the value of 2 cross 1 you got here? 2 cross is equal to 1.22. That is, you got 1.22 you got. Next, similarly you go for 3 cross 1. What is the value of 3 cross 1? It is minus 1.84. That's what I have written here. See here, minus 3.84. Next, 4 cross 1. Where is my 4 cross 1? That is minus 1.22. That is available on K1 matrix. Okay. Now, 5 cross 1. Here, there is no 5 cross 1 available in both the K1 and K2 matrices. That will be 0. Again, for 6 cross 1 will be 0. Now, you go for second row for the global stiffness matrix. 1 cross 2. 1 cross 2 now, look into the K1 matrix, stiffness matrix, 1 cross 2, that is 1.22, it is not available again in K2, okay, just you write down 1.22. Next, 2 cross 2, 2 cross 2, where is my 2 cross 2, that is situated on K1 matrix, stiffness matrix, that is 2 cross 2 is equal to how much, 0.815, okay, just that's what I have written here, 0.815. Next, go for 3 cross 2 now. Where is 3 cross 2? It is not available on K2, just is available on, again on K1 stiffness matrix. 3 cross 2 is how much? Minus 1.22. Minus 1.22. Again, go for 4 cross 2. Where is 4 cross 2 now? It is available on K1 stiffness matrix. That is minus 0.815. I have written. Again, 5 cross 2 is not going to be available in both the stiffness matrix. If it is not available directly, write 0. Again, for 6 also, it will be 0. Now you go for again third row, for creation of third row, 1 cross 3. Where is my 1 cross 3 here? Again, that value will be available in K1 stiffness matrix, that is minus 1.84. Minus 1.84 I have written there. And similarly you go for 2 cross 3. Similarly you go for 2 cross 3, that is available on K1 stiffness matrix. How much that is? 2 cross 3, that is minus 1.22. The minus 1.22 return. Now be careful here. 3 cross 3. Where is my 3 cross 3? 3 cross 3 for will be going to be available on K1 stiffness matrix. Also, it is be available on K2 stiffness matrix. That's why I compel you to write 1, 2, 3, 4 so that it will be easy for adding some of the magnitude values that will be available in both the matrices. Now, 3 cross 3, how much here in K1 stiffness matrix? That is 1.84. And again, it will be situated on K2 stiffness matrix. That's value is 2.66. If we add, you're going to get 4.5. Okay. Now, what is the next year? 4 cross 3. How much is 4 cross 3 here? The 4 cross 3 will be againable on both the stiffness matrices. That's value is here. 4 cross is 1.22. But here, value is 4 cross 3, 0. Directly, you write 1.22. Similarly, 5 cross 3. 5 cross 3, it is not going to be available in K1 matrix. You go for, again, in that will be available on K2 stiffness matrix. That is, 3 cross 5 is nothing but minus 2.66. Next, you go for 6 cross 3. 6 cross 3 will be 0. Next, how now go for creation of row, fourth row in your global stiffness matrix. Fourth row now. 1 cross 4. Your 1 cross 4 will not going to be situated on either of the, see, 1 cross 4, it is available, sorry, it is available now, 1 cross 4, 1 cross 4 is minus 1.22 now, okay, it is available on K1 stiffness matrix now,
write down here 1 minus 1.22. Next 2 cross 4. What is 2 cross 4 magnitude values here? 2 cross 4, that is minus 0.815. Next 3 cross 4. Again 3 cross 4 will be available here. On both the stiffness matrix, 3 cross 4 will be again 1.22 plus 3 cross 4 will be 0. If you add again, you will get same 1.3 cross 4, that is 0.853 cross 4, that is 1.22. Next, again go for 4 cross 4. 4 cross 4 is how much for here? K1 matrix here. K1 matrix here, 4 cross 4 equal to 0.815. Similarly, 4 cross 4 will be 0, directly write it 0.815. Similarly, you go for 5 cross 4. 5 cross 4 will be available on K2 stiffness matrix, that's value will be 0. And 6 cross 4 will be again, it will be situated on K2 stiffness matrix, that will be 0. Now you go for creation of 5th row in your global stiffness matrix. Next, 1 cross 5. 1 cross 5, it is not going to be available there. Directly write 0. Again, 2 cross 5, that is not going to be available. Just you write 0 for that. Next, 3 cross 5, yes, obviously it is available on K2 matrix, that is minus 2.66. And 4 cross 5, that will be 0, that is available on K2 stiffness matrix. Next, 5 cross 5, obviously that is available on K2 stiffness matrix, that is 2.66. Here, that is what 2.66 have written here. Next here, 6 cross 5, that will be 0. Next, creation of again, last row of your global stiffness matrix. 1 cross 6, everything will be 0, that is not going to be available on your any one of the stiffness matrices, that is K1 and K2 matrices. Okay, so this is how you have created your global stiffness matrix. What is the next step here? Next, creation of global force vector. What is global force vector? You have to write capital F is equal to F1, F2, F3, F4, F5, 6. See, these are the force vectors you need to represent with respect to degrees of freedom of the particular unit, particular nodes. See, here in bar members, you represent 1, 2 means 2 nodes means you are representing F1 and F2. Here you need to represent 3 nodes are there. Each one having 2 degrees of freedom. That's why you have to write 6 degrees of freedom. That's why how many degrees of freedom that is situated. As for the, you need to represent forces 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 with respect to X, Y, with respect to X with respect to Y for the particular nodes you need to represent. Okay, just you observe here. F1, F2, F3 here. Just look into the first figure here. Load will be given. Load has given load. Yes or no? Here, just you created Q1 and see F1 you have to represent it along with Q1 you have to represent F1. That is along force along X axis. With along with Q2 you have to represent F2. That is along Y axis. So the both will be 0 because they are not given their force vectors. Force value is not given. Just when you come to node, to be careful here. Q3, F3 you have to represent. F3 is force along X axis and Q4 is nothing but that is F4 along Y axis. The load is acting now. Node 2, that is in Y axis, but is acting in downward direction. That's why its value will be again minus 50 10 to the power of 3 Newton you need to take for that. Again here F5, F6 will be 0 because no force is acting with respect to figure they have given. That's why directly I have taken 0 for that. See here, that's why F1, F2, F3 will be 0, but at exactly at node 2 in direction of Y, that is F4 is acting, that in negative direction is acting. That's why I have taken minus 50 kN. Remaining will be 0, 0 because there is no force acting at node 1 and node 3rd. Now, what is the next step here? Next step is what? Creation of equation of equilibrium for the entire structure. Already you told for all the structural members, the equation of equilibrium is equal to QQ is equal to F. Just now I got the value of global stiffness matrix and you represent how many degrees of freedom here. As for that, you represent Q1, Q2, Q3, Q4, Q5 and Q6. Similarly for F also you represent, but F4 is given that to acting negative direction. That's why I have taken minus 50 kN and remaining will be 0. This completes your formation equation of equilibrium. Next thing is what? Next step is what? Application of boundary condition. Application of boundary condition. Now, I told there are two steps for using application of boundary condition. Applying boundary condition. Those steps are, one is penalty approach method, another one is elimination method. So if you don't mention anything, it's better you go for elimination method. In elimination method, it says that wherever the node is fixed, nothing but here, what are the nodes fixed? 1 and
Third node is fixed here. Just you observe the figure here. Go to the first slide. First and third node is fixed here. Nothing but first and third node. Nothing but total how many degrees of freedoms are there? Total 4 degrees of freedoms will be there with respect to one node, with respect to second, total 4 degrees of freedom. What are those degrees of freedoms? Q1, Q2 and Q5, Q6. Nothing but here 4 degrees of freedoms will be locked here. Oh, got the idea or not? See here, which one? Q1, Q2, Q5 and Q6. Q3, Q4 is we need to calculate because there is no boundary condition there applied now. Have you got the idea or not? One and third node is fixed. For one node, you have a 2 degrees of freedom. Those nodal values are Q1 and Q2. Those are fixed. That we need to eliminate now. The elimination method says that wherever the node is fixed, corresponding rows and columns with respect to global stiffness matrix, or sorry, with respect to equation equilibrium, that will be entire row and entire column will be eliminated. You got the idea or not? Once again, I am going to repeat. Wherever the nodes are fixed, that particular row and column from the equation of equilibrium will be eliminated. Complete. First, your example. See here, first node here. What are the degrees of freedom will be eliminated now? Q1 and Q2. Nothing but first row of the entire equation equilibrium will be eliminated along with first column. Similarly, for Q2, second row and second column will be eliminated. Similarly, if your third node is fixed, and their corresponding displacement values are Q5 and Q6, and nothing but Q5, nothing but fifth row and fifth column will be eliminated. 6 means sixth row and sixth column will be eliminated. After elimination is completed, the remaining terms are 4.5, 1.22 in the matrix of 1.22 and 0.85, and it is into 10 to the power of 5. Remaining terms are Q3, Q4 is equal to 0. Global force vector now reduced to 0 minus 50 kilonewton. By solving this simple problem, we are going to get the values of Q3 and Q4. The value you got Q3 is 0.279 mm and Q4 is -1.03. These two are the displacement that will going to be happen due to the application of 50 kilonewton acting at node 2, that in downward direction. Now, how to calculate stresses in each element? For that, you have a formula. Sigma 1 is equal to E by L. Okay, L nothing but effective length of the element, equal into the C into minus L minus M L M into your coordinate system, which are comes under first element. What are the coordinate axis comes under element? Two nodes, obviously. The degrees of freedom will be for two nodes will be Q1, Q2 for first element, Q3, Q4 for second element. You have to represent. Why I am stressing is, for second element, you are writing for second element, the Q1, Q2 doesn't come into picture because second element is made up of node 2 and 3. There the your nodal values comes from Q3, Q4, Q5, Q6, not Q1, Q2. Okay. Again, E will be common, 2 into 10 to the power of 5. The effective length is calculated at the beginning using Pythagoras theorem, and minus L, that the value you got on the first element using L formula and M formula you got, that is direction of cosines for the first element you have to write, and you have to write Q1, Q2 will be fixed there, and you got just now you got the value Q3, Q4. Now you just multiply here. Sir, if you multiply here for left hand side first, 2 into 10 to the power of 5 divided by 901, if you do it, you will get 221.88. that if you multiply here row versus column now, 0 0, just you multiply 0.32 into 0.29, you will get this value, and also similarly for 0.55 and -1.03, if you multiply you get this value. After substitution, you're going to get sigma 1 is equal to -75.13 newton per mm square. Similarly, you go for next, again for next element, again same formula, E by L minus L minus M L M. Here L and M will be different. For first element is different, for second element it is different. Okay, next you into your global displacement vector starts with Q3, not with Q1, because it starts with second one and third node. Their particular displacement vectors are start with Q3, Q4 and Q5, Q6 will be 0. Q3, Q4 just now you calculated. As for the same procedure, you need to multiply and you will get the value of the stresses that will be induced in the particular structure. So this is how we need to calculate the displacement values along with the corresponding stresses in each element due to the application of load for the structure. Okay, I hope you understood this concept. See, if you have any doubt regarding this concept, just you add a comment in the Google Classroom so that I will going to rectify those problems. Again, I'll solve in the next video. Okay, thank you.